Hello everyone and welcome back to the channel. This is Nigdha Mahapatra, a third year student from KIT School of Law and currently an intern under LexClick. So the topic for today's video is misjoinder and its effects. Now the civil cases start with the institution of the case by one party against that of the another party, and the competent court decides the rights and liabilities of both parties. Order 1 of the Code of Civil Procedure 1908 deals with the parties to the suit and also contains provisions regarding addition and deletion and substitution of parties, or joinder or non-joinder and misjoinder of parties, and objections to misjoinder and non-joinder. In this video, I will be talking about one such component, that is misjoinder of parties. Now first, let us talk about what is a misjoinder. The joinder of any person or as a party to the suit contrary to the provisions of the code is called a misjoinder. Misjoinder may be a misjoinder of plaintiffs or a misjoinder of defendants or that of a misjoinder of cause of action. Now, what is a misjoinder of plaintiffs? When two or more persons may have been joined as plaintiffs in one suit, but the right to relief alleged to exist in each plaintiff does not arise out of the same act or transaction or out of the same series of acts or transactions, and if separate suits were brought by each plaintiff and there exists no common question of fact or law that would have arisen, there is a misjoinder of plaintiffs. The objection on the ground of misjoinder of plaintiffs should be taken at the earliest opportunity, and if it is not, it is deemed to have been waived. Now next comes the misjoinder of defendants. Now likewise, when there are two or more persons who have been joined as defendants in one suit, but the right to relief alleged to exist against each defendant does not rise out of the same act or same transaction or the same series of acts or transactions, and if separate suits were brought against each defendant wherein no common question of fact or law would have arisen, there is a misjoinder of defendants. Next is the misjoinder of cause of action. Misjoinder of cause of action may be coupled with misjoinder of plaintiffs or misjoinder of defendants. Thus, the subject may be considered under the following three heads. First is misjoinder of plaintiffs and cause of action. Where in a suit there are two or more plaintiffs and two or more causes of action, the plaintiffs should be jointly interested in all the causes of action. If the plaintiffs are not jointly interested in all the causes of action, the case is one of misjoinder of plaintiffs and cause of action. The object on the ground of misjoinder of plaintiffs and causes of action should be taken at the earliest opportunity. Now the second head is misjoinder of defendant and cause of action. Where in a suit there are two or more defendants and two or more cause of action, the suit will be bad for misjoinder of defendants and causes of action if different causes of action are joined against different defendants separately. Such a misjoinder is technically called as multifariousness. The objection on the ground of multifariousness should be taken at the earliest opportunity. Now let us take an example here. In a suit for recovery of loan advanced on an overdraft account, the joinder of a claim against the agent on the ground that he had acted in excess of his authority, and against the managing director on the ground that he had approved of it, would render the action of multifariousness. Now another example is in a case where the plaintiff purchased a house in which two persons are residing as tenants separately, and he brought a suit for eviction against both the defendant tenants claiming different relief against them. This was held that the suit was bad for multifariousness. Now the third head is misjoinder of claims founded on several causes of action. Order 2 of the Code of Civil Procedure deals with the misjoinder of claims founded on several claims. According to the rule, every suit must include the whole claim which the plaintiff is entitled to make in respect of that cause of action. The question of whether or not there is a misjoinder of parties has to be decided on the basis of the averments made in the plaint and not reference either to the written statement or on the evidence led by the parties. Rule 9 expressly and unequivocally declares that no suit is liable to be dismissed by reason of misjoinder of parties. In other words, misjoinder of parties is not fatal to the suit. It is a mere irregularity. Hence, the various high courts on the question of misjoinder of parties held that no decree shall be reversed or substantially varied, nor shall a case be remanded in appeal inter alia on account of misjoinder of parties, not affecting the merits of the case or the jurisdiction of the court. Where there is a misjoinder of parties, the name of the plaintiff and the defendant who has been improperly joined may be struck out under Rule 10 and the case may be proceeded with. In the case of Patsibai versus Ratan Lal, an application for the correction of misdescription of the defendant in the plaint was allowed. The correction could not be incorporated in the plaint, but the misdescription did not mislead any party. In fact, the written statement and the documents in appeal carried the correct name. It was held that the decree was valid. Thank you so much for watching the video. Please subscribe to the channel for further and daily updates.